we get started this morning, I want to ask you a question. When I mention the word mother, what do you think about? I came across an article where a group of second graders were asked a series of questions concerning what they thought about their mother, and the answers they gave are quite fascinating. In fact, they're downright hilarious. Let me just share a few of them with you this morning. Here's the first one. These kids were asked, why did God make mothers? And one of the little kids said, well, to help us out of there when we were getting born. And another question was, how did God make mothers? Well, magic plus superpowers and a lot of stirring. But what ingredients are mothers made of? Well, God made mothers out of clouds and angels' hair and everything nice in the whole world. And one dad of mean. What kind of little girl was your mother? One kid said, I don't know because I wasn't there. But my guess was that she was pretty bossy. But now they did say that she used to be nice. Well, who is the boss at your house? One little kid said, well, Mom is. She doesn't want to be, but she has to because Dad can't do anything by himself. Well, what would it take to make your mom perfect? One little kid said, on the inside, she is perfect already. But maybe a little bit of plastic surgery. And then here's one more. If you could change one thing about your mom, what would it be? One little kid said, well, I would like for her to get rid of those eyes in the back of her head. You know those invisible eyes that moms have? They see everything, don't they? Well, I didn't share that with you just to keep you laugh, although I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I just want to make this point. It's one thing what we think about moms. But today I'm going to tell you what God thinks about moms. And that's something altogether different, is what God thinks about moms. And the wisest man who ever lived, King Solomon, devoted, in essence, an entire chapter, Proverbs 31, just go ahead and open your Bible there. He devoted nearly an entire chapter to the wonders of a wonderful woman who is a wife and a mother. Proverbs 31. But now I want you to bear with me for just a few minutes. Like Barry said, I'm going to be long-winded, I guess, as per usual. But I want to say a few things about this chapter before we get into it, because I've preached from this passage numerous times through the years. It's been a while, but nearly every time that I do, some good sister will come up to me and she'll tell me how this chapter makes her feel inadequate, how that she feels like she's never going to be able to measure up, because this woman in Proverbs 31, the Proverbs 31 woman, appears, by all accounts, to be perfect. Do any of you ladies, I mean even at the mention of Proverbs 31, do you have this sinking feeling that you somehow just don't measure up? You feel that way? If you do, I understand. And many women, when they read Proverbs 31, or they hear a sermon on this passage of Scripture, they feel like a failure. And if you take it the wrong way, the Proverbs 31 woman can make you feel woefully inadequate. And some women, therefore, they just try to ignore the Proverbs 31 wife and mother altogether. And my heart feels especially tender towards those who would rather just skip over Proverbs 31. Please don't do that. Now, I know better than anyone in this room this morning what those words, not enough, how heavy they are when they sit upon your heart. I know what that feels like. I think we all do. But I want to tell you that the sentiment behind Proverbs 31 is one of celebration, not condemnation. This is not meant to condemn you. This is actually a celebration of what a good woman is and what a good woman does. So let me give you just a few preliminary considerations. And I think these are important. And I thought I'd just skip over all this and point out two or three applications, but I think it's important to look at these things so that you won't get the wrong idea and end up feeling like you don't measure up. So here's the first thing I want you to understand. This description of the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31 was written to a man. This was written to the man. Now, we typically start with verse 10 when we're preaching about this woman, but you really need to back up to verse 1 to get the context. In Proverbs chapter 31 and verse 1, it says, "The sayings of King Lemuel and inspired utterance his mother taught him." In other words, King Lemuel's just writing the advice that he was given by his mother. This was given by a woman to a man. This was not given by a man to women, kind of like a measuring stick to say, okay, let's see if you measure up or not. This is not a checklist. This was written by a mother to his son, in essence, to give him advice about finding a good wife, a woman that would be a good wife and a good mother. So Proverbs 31 is one woman's motherly advice. It is not an overarching prescription. In verses 2 and 3, it says, "Listen, my son." This is the mother of King Lemuel. "Listen, my son. Listen, son of my womb." In other words, she's saying, I gave birth to you. Listen to me, my son. "Do not spend your strength on women, your vigor on those who rule kings." So Proverbs 31 was not written to instruct all virtuous women everywhere on how to measure up. That's not the intent. It was written for a man to inspire him as to what type of woman he should be looking for. Now, if you read this in context, the mother is basically telling her son, don't make bad choices. Don't get drunk. Don't devote yourself to alcohol. Don't chase women. Treat others well and find yourself a good, godly wife. That's what this really is all about. It's not as if though this is saying, now, you Christian women, you must do every single one of these things, all of them, every day, without fail, and if you don't, you don't measure up. That's not the intent of this passage. And if you see it as such, you will feel woefully inadequate. You'll feel terrible about yourself. Now, let me also say that in Jewish culture, Proverbs 31 is actually a song of praise. In Jewish culture, it is the men who memorize Proverbs 31, not the women. And these men would memorize it so that they could sing it as a strong praise to the women in their lives, to their wives, to their daughters, to their sisters, to their mothers, and even to their friends. A Jewish woman, her husband would sing Proverbs 31 to her at every Sabbath meal. It was meant to be a celebration of a godly woman. According to Jewish culture, the phrase, who can find a virtuous woman, and we'll look at that, but in Proverbs 31 verse 10, the question is asked, who can find a virtuous woman? That comes from the Hebrew word eshet keil. And it is translated woman of valor. This is a poem of celebration for a woman of courage and strength. Rather than using this virtuous woman description as a guilt-inducing measuring stick, Jewish women, in fact, would praise each other with it, with a hearty eshet keil. That'd be like you saying, you go, girl, if you're a Christian, you go. Woman of valor. These women would express these sentiments to each other with these words. You're awesome. That's what this is saying. If you know the Lord and you love the Lord and you're letting the Lord lead you and guide you, whatever your circumstance, you go, girl. That's what this is saying. And that's what I want to say to all of you godly women here this morning. The virtuous woman is an allegory character, I believe. I won't argue that, but I don't believe that she is a real person. Scholars aren't 100% in agreement about this, but most likely this is not a real woman. Rather, this woman is a compilation of the best traits of godly women as a whole. In fact, if you read through the entire book of Proverbs, and I've preached through Proverbs many, many times, you'll meet three other allegorical characters, and you will not think that any of those are an actual person. You'll read about wisdom. Wisdom is personified as a woman in Proverbs. You'll read about folly. Folly is also personified as a woman. You'll read about the adulteress. The adulteress is personified as a woman. No one considers these three women to be real people, and the Proverbs 31 woman probably isn't either. Rather, she completes the set of four. Wisdom and folly, those two go together, and they are contrast, and that's what Proverbs are. Wisdom and folly go together, and the adulteress and the wife of noble character go together, and they are also a contrast. Now, even if this virtuous woman, if she is a real person, the text seems to indicate that she probably was not a young woman with little children at home, but rather a woman of years, a woman who had years of experience, a woman of wisdom, a woman that had time to develop, and also that she didn't do all of these things all at the same time. This is probably a description of a godly woman's life, looking back in perspective over it all. The good things she did, not necessarily all at one time, but the good things that she did in her life because she loved God. Because she loved God, she loved her husband, and she loved her children and her family. So this is probably a composite of all the good things that you could say about a godly woman. Proverbs 31 is simply the highlight reel of the best things that this wife of noble character did in the various seasons over the course of her entire life. But you're only getting one side of the story. You understand that, right? This is a mother saying to her son, now don't go chasing women. That'll bring you ruin. Now, you need a godly wife, and here's why. You need a godly life, and this is what she's going to look like. Well, this mother is going to highlight all of the positive things that she can think of that would be found in a godly woman. She's not necessarily trying to point out her faults or to pick at her flaws. She's trying to convince her son that her son needs a godly woman. Well, mother's not going to be picking out the flaws. She's going to be highlighting the positives. And that's what you see in Proverbs 31. Now, I'm not saying any of this to diminish the impact of Proverbs 31. I just don't want you godly women to read this the wrong way and feel bad about yourselves. If you love God, if you're seeking to do His will, then you go.
Amen.
You keep trusting Him and you keep following Him, and He'll make you to be this woman.
Yeah.
You'll be this woman. You'll be a blessing to your husband and to your family. But this virtuous woman, she isn't weak, and she isn't passive. She isn't the family maid. Proverbs 31 verse 17 says she sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. And I feel like sometimes women get so hung up on submission, and of course they are to be submissive to their husbands, but they think that in order to be a Proverbs 31 wife, that they have to be quiet, they have to keep all of their opinions to themselves. They have to let their husbands do whatever they want to do, even when their husbands are making decisions that are bad, decisions that they don't agree with. And I don't think that's the case. This woman is a very confident woman. She's very capable. She's confident. She's self-assured. And her husband doesn't try to thwart that. He goes to the city gate to conduct official business and trusts her to take care of the home because she's got a lot going on. He doesn't have to worry about the kids. He doesn't have to worry about the finances. He doesn't have to worry about the things that's going on at home because he's got a godly wife that he can trust. This woman, the scripture tells us that her husband has full confidence in her. She considers a field, for instance. She buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. And she's clothed with strength and dignity. That's what this passage is saying. So the wife of noble character honors her husband. She reflects him well, but she's still her own person with her own skills, her own strengths, her own abilities. She's not just the family maid. And if you're a man and you treat your wife like that's all she is, friend, you we need to come back to the scriptures, find out what the Bible has to say about that. But she's not a man. And then let me say one more thing here. There's more than one way to be a virtuous woman. You remember I said, who can find a virtuous woman? That comes right out of this passage in verse 10. That comes from the Hebrew word, eshet, ke'il, and it's translated woman of valor. Well, as it turns out, Proverbs 31 is not the only place where this Hebrew term is mentioned in the Bible. You'll also find it in the book of Ruth. In Ruth chapter 3 and verse 11, Boaz calls Ruth a woman of valor. He is saying the same thing about Ruth that King Lemuel's mother is saying about this godly woman in Proverbs 31. In fact, it says, "And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All the people of my town know that you are a woman of noble character." That's Boaz speaking to Ruth. Now, how often do Christian women assume that if they want to be a virtuous woman, they have to be wives, they have to be mothers, they have to be homemakers? Well, that's all well and good, and of course the Bible promotes that. But guess what? Ruth was none of that. Was she? I mean, she didn't have servants like the woman in Proverbs 31. She was so poor that she had to go into the field and glean the leftovers there of Boaz's field. She wasn't a wife. She had been, but her husband had died. He left her without any children, so she wasn't a mother. She had next to no money, no resources to her name. No one would have envied Ruth's life. And yet Boaz says, "You are a woman of valor." Why is that? Because in Ruth's circumstance, she loved God and was serving God. She was doing the best she could with what God gave her, just like the Proverbs woman in Proverbs 31, you see. There's more than one way to go about being a godly woman and a woman of virtue. What I'm trying to say is, don't look at this as a checklist. Love God and serve God, and He'll help you with all the rest of that. All the rest of that will become an outflow of you first loving and serving Him. So there's more than one way to be a virtuous woman. Now I want you to take a look just for a moment at a few things that this Proverbs 31 woman is not, because I want to help all of us to see that it is very possible, in fact, to be a diligent, hardworking, and beautiful woman of God in these modern times. It is possible to do that. But in order to help you, you've got to understand what this woman was not. She was not perfect. This woman was not perfect. That may sound shocking when you read the text. But if you read through Proverbs 31, there's not one verse that describes a flaw in this woman. That's a red flag to me. All 22 verses highlight good and positive actions and qualities. Yet a fundamental truth in the Bible that has to be remembered here when you read this passage is that there is no one perfect except for who? Only Jesus. No one else. The Proverbs 31 woman is not perfect. She cannot be. She is a sinner who is in need of God's grace and in need of God's saving, just like everybody else. You've got to understand that on the other side of the coin, this woman didn't get it all right all the time. Everything did not work out the way she wanted it to all the time. She made some mistakes along the way. She messed up. I can tell you that because that's the lot of all of us, isn't it? It's just that all of her positive qualities are being highlighted. Now, if someone wanted to, they could come up here and tell you about me and highlight all the positives about me and make you think that I'm a pretty good guy. But if Wendy got up here and told you all the rest of the story, you wouldn't think so much of me. She could tell you what a lot of other people don't know, you see. There's two sides to this story, and I can assure you that this woman is not perfect, and neither is she Superwoman or Wonder Woman. This passage contains a lot of action verses, doing verses. She's doing this, she's doing that, and it's easy to think that she does it all the time. But this woman is not Superwoman. She's not Wonder Woman. This woman, I guarantee you, needed to rest just like everyone else needed to rest, just like you need to rest. Like I do. She needed time to herself, just like Jesus needed time to Him. But I guarantee you, she had days when she just didn't have the energy to accomplish it all, and maybe she just didn't want to accomplish it all. You know, you have days like that. She had some bad days along with those good days, because she is not perfect and she is not Wonder Woman. And we endure that same thing. We need rest no matter what God's having us to do. We need time to ourselves. We need quiet time with the Lord. We have good days when things go right. We have bad days when nothing seems to get done. And that's okay. That's just the way life is. So this woman is not Superwoman. And then let me say that she's not alone. And that's very important to understand. She's doing a lot, but she's not doing it by herself. You read through this passage and you just take a mental note here of the other people that are mentioned besides this woman. I found five. You may find others. If you do, let me know. But in this context, there's her husband doing his thing. There are her maidens, those of her household. They're doing their thing. There's the elders of the land. There's the merchants. And there's her children. She's not doing any of this on her own, alone. Some people read this and they think that this woman, well, what a woman she is, because she's doing all these things all by herself, all on her own, with her own resources, with no help. And that simply cannot be the case. Her husband is her provider and her protector. Though she works to provide for her household and her children, her husband has the greater responsibility. She has children in her home. She has elders in her town. Just like women today, they have husbands, they have children, they have the elders of the local church, they have their extended family members. You may or may not have the ability to have someone come in and clean your house, but if not, you probably have friends or people that could help you if you needed it. So no woman is on her own. I want you to understand that. Then let me also say that this Proverbs 31 woman is not doing before following. This is a very important point. It's easy to view this Proverbs 31 woman and think that she's just a natural go-getter. 14 verses describe her as doing something, and they're no small task. Now, to me, I see her as one of these women with an overabundance of motivation. Would you think of her in that way? To me, I see her as one of these ladies who just has this natural motivation. She has this inner drive, and she's doing all these amazing things because she was just born that way, and she's just one of those lucky individuals that just can do it all. But friend, that's not the case. I assure you, that is not the case. She may have been highly motivated, she may not have been. But regardless, it's clear in verse 30 that her driving force, before anything else, is the Lord.
Amen.
She's doing all these things. It's not like she's doing all these things and then serving the Lord. No. She's serving the Lord, and because of that, she is then doing all these other things. She's not doing these tasks and then fearing the Lord. Rather, her actions and her deeds are the result of her faith, just like Rahab and Ruth and Mary and others in the Scripture. So this woman is not doing it alone. And I want to say one more thing. She is not pouring out without pouring in first. You know, you can't feed unless you're fed, right? As the old saying goes, it's hard to give what you don't have. You've got to fill your tank before you can empty it out for someone else. It's important to take care of yourself physically, and I'm not saying otherwise, but it is near impossible to give others, whether it be your time, your money, materials, whatever, without Jesus first filling your cup. You've got to let the Lord pour into your life in order for you to ever pour out of your life to be a benefit or a blessing to others. The Proverbs 31 woman passage doesn't tell us about her quiet times with the Lord, but you know she had those. It doesn't tell us how she prayed and when she prayed and who she prayed for, but you know she was doing those things, right? The Bible here doesn't tell us what verses were convicting her or what verses were giving her strength. It doesn't talk about her heart, what she needed to rely on. And obviously, what she needed to rely on as she did all these things for her husband and her family was the Lord. And she relied on Him most of all. And this is the reason why she is a woman of valor in the first place. And that's the reason why I can say with confidence, this passage of Scripture is a celebration of that woman. That woman. Notice what it says here. Charmed is deceitful. This is King Lemuel's mother coming to a conclusion in verse 30. She says all these things about this godly woman. She's trying to encourage him, go for her, go after her, whatever you do. And she wraps it up by saying, charm is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord. There it is. And that's it right there. A woman who fears the Lord is to be praised.
Yeah.
That's the point. I read this passage of Scripture, read about this woman, and I see the reflection of many good women in our congregation, some that I knew who've gone on to be with the Lord. And if I've ever known a Proverbs 31 woman, I am telling you that it is my precious bride. My wife.
Amen.
Children are sweet and dads are super, but moms are special. The father may be the head of the house and the children may be the hub of the home, but without any question, the mother is the heart of the home if she knows and loves the Lord. Mm-hmm. Now, this chapter is the longest description of any family member found in the Bible. Now, that should tell you how important a godly woman is, a wife and a mother. And what's most fascinating is that this is actually an acrostic. That's why I think men memorized it, were able to recite it, because they could just go from the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet to the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and they'd be able to get all of these things in. So this is the A to Z of the virtuous woman. That's what Proverbs 31 is. And with the few minutes that we have remaining, I want to make three applications. There's so much more that can be said, but I'm going to just kind of put it all together into three major headings. And if you get these three things, I think you'll have a pretty good understanding of what this virtuous woman would look like even today. Here's the first thing. A godly woman and mother portrays character in the home. I mean, that's just one large category. When you put a lot of this together, it just really boils down to this. She portrays character in the home. Now, I want you to keep in mind what's being described here is the ideal mother. It's not necessarily something that you'll be able to achieve, or at least achieve all at once, but it is a standard in which every mother should want to aspire. And it begins with this question in verse 10 of chapter 31. An excellent wife who can find, she is far more precious than jewels. The actual, the Hebrew word there translated, many English versions of the Bible, jewels, actually would be rubies. The word excellent refers to moral strength, it refers to spiritual strength, it refers, in other words, to a woman of tremendous character and integrity. That's who she is. She's just real. All the way down to the very recesses of her heart and soul, this woman has integrity. You know, women, just like men, are a dime a dozen, but a woman of honor, a woman of virtue, a woman of character, they're priceless. And that's why King Lemuel's mother said, who can find a woman like that? That's why he doesn't ask who can buy an excellent wife. Well, no one can, because she's not for sale. He says, who can find an excellent wife? You've got to look for this woman. You've got to find this woman. It's easy to find a woman, perhaps with looks. She may even have a certain measure of success. She may have some money. She may have style. She may be educated. But the first thing that every single man should look for when he's looking for a woman is a woman of godly virtue, a woman of character, a woman of spirituality and godliness.
Right.
Now, these are things that will last. That's why in verse 30, when she comes to the end of it all, she says, well, charm, beauty, those won't last. But a godly woman, a woman that fears God, is to be praised, because that's what will last. Someone said beauty is only skin deep. Yeah, someone else put it like that. Beauty is only skin deep. Ugly goes to the bone. Beauty simply fades away. Ugly holds its own. Wrinkles come, bodies sag, bags stoop, legs give in, but a good godly heart full of grace is strong to the end. And that is absolutely a fact.
Amen.
I want to say to every man here who is married and every man who may be in the process of getting married, the two most important decisions that you are going to make in this life are, number one, who will be the Lord that I serve? And number two, who will be the lady I love? I mean, those two things are going to impact you more than anything else that you ever do. That first one will decide whether or not you are in heaven or hell in eternity. So you need to accept Christ on His terms so that your soul will be saved in the day of His wrath. But that second decision, the lady you love, well, I tell you, that'll make life here on earth either like heaven or hell. I'm telling you, the woman that you marry, who she is, that's going to determine a lot about the way your life goes. And that's why King Lemuel's mother wants him not to just chase after women, but to find a godly woman. Now, how do I know that this is referring to the character of a woman? How do you think her worth is compared to rubies instead of diamonds? Why do you think he does that? Well, diamonds, they catch the light and reflect. But rubies, they have this inner glow. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about the beauty that's on the inside, not the beauty that's on the outside. He's talking about a woman's character. He goes on to say in verse 11, the heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. He can trust her in his heart because she is a woman of character. Now, he's speaking here primarily in the area of money and managing the finances at home, but it's more broad than that. He can trust her. I mean, he can trust his wife. Wendy and I have a good marriage. It's not perfect, and most of our problems are my fault, I'll be honest. But the reason that we have the good marriage that we have is because I can trust my wife 100%. 100%. And if you have a spouse like that, oh, you are so blessed. She, my wife, has my total trust. I trust her with our finances. And more than trusting her with our finances or managing our home, I trust her to manage herself. That's what you need to look for. That's what Solomon is saying. What is the mark of a good wife and a good mother? Well, she's good to her husband and she's good for her husband, because in verse 12 it says here, she does him good and no harm all the days of his life. She's just a fountain of blessing that never runs dry. She does her husband good in every way. She's his greatest encourager. She's the cheerleader of the family. She doesn't speak evil of her husband, of his character. She doesn't speak evil of him in public or in private. She does not tear him down. She does not attack him as the husband and father in the home. Because you see, she's a woman of character. She's a woman of nobility. To put it simply, this woman is a model of character in the home. Now that's because first she loves God. She wants to please God. So that's just put on display in the home. And here's the second thing I want you to see. A godly mother provides competence in the home. And if I had more time, I could go through all of this, but let me just give you the verses here. Verse 13 says, she seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She's not the kind of woman that has to be forced to do things in the home. She's not the kind of woman that would rather be somewhere else. She wants to be in the home. She wants to be caring for her family. With willing hands, she does what they need because they are the center of her life. That's what she cares about more than anything else. She may work outside the home. She may do other things outside the home. But her family is her first priority. She is a mother that provides competence in the home. She clothes her family, clothes them well. And, of course, they have to eat. And Proverbs 31, 14, and 15 says, she like the ships of the merchant. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it's yet night and provides food for her household and portions for her handmaidens. This woman is not afraid to go the extra mile to find the best bargain she can and the best food for her family. On top of that, she's willing to get up early in the day and stay up late in the night just to make sure that the needs of her family are taken care of. Now, if your home is like mine, or as my home has been, when the kids got sick growing up, do you know whose name they called out in the middle of the night? Mom, I'm sick. When I was sick, you know whose name I called? Saying, Wendy, I'm sick. Take care of me. Now, we find something else interesting about this particular woman here in verse 16. It says she considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. And evidently, this was a working mother. I think it's best that a woman stay home and raise her kids. I'm not going to ever say otherwise. But she had some type of job. And she made money with it. In fact, she made enough that she could save it. And when she had saved enough, she found the field. And she bought that field with the plans of providing income for the family. Providing extra money in case her family needed it. Now, I thank God for mothers who stay at home, and I thank God for mothers who work. Wendy got to stay home a lot when our kids were small, but she had to work a lot because I decided to be a gospel preacher, and that put us in financial hardship much of the time when our kids were young. So she worked to support our family so I could preach the gospel. I appreciate women that stay home, and I wish all women could stay home, but some women, they have to work. My mother worked when I was growing up to help my father with the financial needs of the family. But what you see here with this woman is that she's contributing. She's not responsible for the family finances, but she's trying to contribute. She's trying to help. She's trying to supplement what her husband's doing so her family's needs can be met. And this mother has it together. We're talking about competence in the home. In verses 17 and 18, she sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. This woman's not afraid to roll up her sleeves and to go to work and do whatever it takes to build a godly home. She knows how to stretch a dollar. She looks for the best buy. And Wendy's like this too. She's managed our finances so well. In fact, she just increased my allowance. I get like $10 a week now. Talk about being competent. And then in verse 19, it says here that in her hand she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. In verse 23, it says her husband is respected at the city gate where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. So not only is she successful, but because of her success, her husband then can be a success. Now, how many of us men here today would say that we would not be where we are, we would not have been able to accomplish what we've accomplished had it not been for that good, godly woman in our life, helping to make it possible? I would not be who I am today, nowhere near that, if it were not for my godly wife, the woman that I married that loves God. In fact, I believe she loves Him more than she does me, and I wouldn't have it any other way. Now, there's one more thing I want you to see here, and I'm going to try to finish on time. And that is, a godly mother promotes chemistry in the home. Character, competence, chemistry. There really is truth to the fact that if mom is happy, everyone is happy, right? And it's not just the way this particular wife and mother works that's so fantastic, but it's in the way that she talks. Just notice this in verse 26. It says, she speaks with wisdom. This mother is a wise woman, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She's a teacher in the home, speaking words of wisdom, no doubt, to her husband as well as to her children. You see, mom understands that she sets the atmosphere in the home really more than anybody else. Mm-hmm. That's why she understands, no doubt through some experience, that screaming and yelling and Those kind of things are probably not going to be affected, but words of wisdom are. Good sound teaching from the Word of God will be. She understands that. Goes about saying it. Mom really is the master teacher. Some of the greatest life lessons that you're ever going to learn are going to be taught to you by your mother. Right? I came across a little article titled, Things Only a Mom Can Teach. Let me share this with you and I'll be finished. My mother taught me anticipation. Just wait till you get home. My mother taught me about receiving. You're going to get it when you get home. My mother taught me about logic. If you fall out of that swing and break your neck, you're not going to the store with me. My mother taught me physiology. If that lawnmower cuts off your toes, don't come running to me. My mother taught me about genetics. You're just like your father. She taught me about justice. One day you'll have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you. Then you'll see what my life's like. And of course, we all do see eventually. I've tried to say so much this morning. I hope that something has been a blessing to you. But I want to end this way. This is really what I want to do. It's Mother's Day. We are so fortunate, us guys. All of us kids, we really, really are. I'm not just saying that because it's Mother's Day. Mother's Day should be every day. I'm saying that because, having lived all these years, I know what a good godly woman. What a blessing that is. If you have a wife or a mother or some lady that you know that loves God, be thankful for her. And take this poem of praise and use it. To rise up and praise her, rise up and call her blessed. One gospel preacher that I know, I'm sure that many of you know him, but his godly mother died not too many years ago. He told me, he said, I had the opportunity to be in the room. He and his brother, who's also a gospel preacher, he said, I was in that room with my mother and we held her in our arms as she was dying. Told her how blessed she was. She said that those guys told her that God saved the best mother of all for them. To rise up and to call your mother blessed. You'll do that if your mother's a godly woman. Not that she doesn't make mistakes. She can't do it all. She doesn't do it all on her own. Everything doesn't work out right. But over the lifetime of this woman, when you begin to put it all together, you begin to see just how awesome she really is. And really, the hero of this story is Jesus.
Right.
Jesus. This godly woman is what she is because of Jesus. And he really is the one that deserves the praise and the honor and the glory for whatever she does, whatever Dad does, whatever I do, whatever you do. If we're ever going to do anything good, it'll be because we first follow him. And after following him, he can bless us to be a blessing in the lives of others. It may be that you're here this morning, you're not a Christian. I can't think of anything that would be more motivating for a person to give their life to Jesus than to know that he can turn your life around and that he can cause you to become a person that not only would be successful, but would be a blessing to the lives of others. If you're a mother here today and you're not a Christian, or if you once were and you've turned away from the Lord, won't you come back to him and let him make of you all that you can be. If you're a man or if you're younger, guy, and you're here and you're not a Christian, give your life to Jesus. Don't waste it on the things of this life. Let him have it. And I guarantee you, if he gets your life, he'll make something of it. You can do that today by repenting of your sins, confessing your faith in Jesus, by being baptized. His blood will cleanse you of your sins, and you'll have the hope of heaven. If you're a Christian who's in error, if you'll repent of your sin and come back to the Lord, he'll forgive you and restore you. And he'll continue his work in your life to be a blessing to you and to others. If we can help you this morning, we'd love to. While we stand together, sing, we invite you to come.
I was sinking deep in sin.